Welcome to Civil War Digital Digest. I'm Will. Well, we're back at the Waterloo Historic Farm Museum, where the Waterloo Historic Society has welcomed us to shoot episodes here, and we really appreciate it. Today is something I've been working for a couple of years, and I'm pretty thrilled. My friend Bill Christen finally got him on camera with us. Bill, if you're in the living history community, you know him all the way back to being a battalion commander, to being a publisher and editor of The Watchdog, to making sure that the Columbia Rifles Research Compendium, the second volume, got published. And today he's going to share more with us. Bill is still active in the Civil War community collecting. And today we're going to talk about men's clothing in the summer. Well, Bill and I went ahead and we both put our sport coats on to look nice and talk with you. And I think as we look back to the 19th century, that may not be the best choice. Let's open up with some of the broad ideas. Talk to me a little bit about men's clothing when it comes to summertime.
You're right. I should have put my Hawaiian shirt on. But in the summertime, men in the 19th century were just as smart as we were. They didn't want to be hot. So they would do things to their outfit to make it at least a little bearable.
So, Bill, when I do living history, about 90% of my wardrobe involves one fabric, wool. It's hotter than I'd like in the summer. What other options do I have?
Cotton, linen, and hemp. And hemp was a more regional fabric in Virginia and Kentucky. But almost anywhere in the United States, you could procure cotton or linen to make clothes. Cotton was used for undergarments mainly, but shirts, and as we can see in the collection here, even trousers at times.
Okay, well, let's talk through the collection, and we'll just make a note that this is a small portion of your collection and the other private collections that you've been able to view over the years. You've picked these pieces. Let's build from the ground up. Let's talk about the trousers.
Okay, the trousers, probably the more typical, were linen, and usually in the oatmeal or tan or unfinished, uncolored version. But remarkably, there were trousers that were very colorful and made out of cotton. Perhaps more in the South than in the North. And these were, to me, a surprise when I was given them by another collector, and with the provenance being somewhere down in Ohio, but they were cotton. And men were wearing something underneath their trousers, and those were drawers. You would have linen or cotton drawers at the time for summertime. And these were still full-length drawers, drawers that stopped at, or only went as far as the knee, or modern underwear as we have today, was more of an early 20th century thing.
Okay, so we're still looking full-length drawers. So we're looking two layers on the bottom
and,
half of our body.
And actually, the muslin of back then was going to help wick the sweat away. And actually, some people were even saying flannel, even though it was a heavier, cotton flannel was a little heavier, it would still help you keep cool.
So you'd have
first-hand reports.
Okay, so you'd have a cotton layer as a base, and then either a cotton, a linen, or maybe a hemp layer next.
And when we get into discussing linen as far as jackets go, I've seen one pair of trousers that belongs to Tom Shaw's collection that were so thin that you needed to have drawers on, or you would be exposed entirely to the world.
Wow, okay. Well, we don't want to have that happen. So, well, let's move up the body, and let's start at the base layer. Let's talk about shirts during the Civil War era.
Here we have a calico shirt. By the 1860s, and actually by the 1850s, shirts were no longer underwear. They weren't considered something that had to be hidden. So we were seeing plaid and calico shirts, and that men didn't have to be afraid to show it off.
Now, this is a more working time. Again, I assume, would this be time and place?
Well, no. I've seen men in their frock coats, actually with their wool frock coats, with plaid shirts and even collarless shirts. So I don't think the sense of wearing a frock coat is as formal as we sometimes think of it. It would be different if you were going to a ball and you had your tailcoat on. Then you'd want to have a nice white shirt.
Or a Sunday morning, go to church.
Right.
So again, a little bit of apply the knowledge to time and place. What you're saying is don't be afraid to show a shirt.
And I've seen a picture of Marion, Indiana, where the guys are out on the street in front of the stagecoach stop. There's men in their shirt sleeves, just their vests, no coats on, sometimes not even a vest on. And this is broad daylight during the day. They could be workers, they could be people traveling, but there was nothing that says you have to wear a coat. Depending on it, if you were the president of the bank, you'd wear your coat. And it may not be the linen one, it might be still your wool regular coat, but with linen trousers.
Okay.
And in your office, you might take the coat off if there wasn't any customers because you wanted to stay warm. For staying cool.
Okay.
And so it's a matter of sometimes applying practicality to what you have.
Okay. Well, so, and this is a Civil War era example of a cotton shirt.
Yes, it is.
Well, let's step up above the shirt. The next layer is always the vest. Do we have a couple here?
Yes,
talk to me about
them. We have two examples. This is an oatmeal linen vest with buttons that are removable so that the vest could be washed, because as you sweat it up, you were going to stain it. So the buttons could be removed and it could be put in the wash. And of course, the wash back then was not an automatic machine at all.
So taking the buttons off will both allow the garment, also caring for the buttons, right?
Right. The buttons, if they were wood, would certainly soften and maybe break or disappear, so to speak. And the metal buttons, if they got wet, they might rust.
Great. So. And in your collection, that I know you have several, the removable buttons, what are they typically made out of?
They're usually a cloth-covered metal button with a shank, or sometimes the ones that are removable would have to have a shank on it. So using the bone buttons that we see on trousers would be a little impractical. Some way of having a shaft and connecting the shank to the holes.
Okay, great. And the other vest?
The other vest is a Marseille cotton vest, and it, in order to stay cool, has pads that are removable. And that was both to make it look like you had a broad chest, but also to keep you from having an extra layer of material between your skin and the vest.
Okay, and you just used a term there that I don't know. What is a Marseille vest?
A Marseille is a cotton fabric that has a raised design to it. It was used in mostly vests. I've seen them. I've seen them in brown. I've seen them in plain cotton. I've seen them with or without any more decoration too.
So. Okay, great. Well, topping it all off on clothing is going to be a jacket of some form, and I see two different types here. What are we looking at?
Well, we have a sack coat here, an unlined linen sack coat. There's no lining so the air can go through it and keep you cool. And we also have a duster that could be worn over your shirt and vest or just over your shirt. And then later on we can show you a frock coat that's unlined frock coat, a very short frock coat that another option.
You said there's something sort of special about this sack coat. What is it?
Well, there were 16 million men in the United States in 1860. So if each man had a nice outfit, a frock coat and maybe a sack coat, and probably more than likely it was a wool one. The fact that we only have one that I've seen, a wool sack coat, and this is the second linen sack coat that I've seen. Wool garments would have been turned into rag rugs, for one thing, if they were salvageable. And the linen itself probably didn't wear as well. And as you can see on this coat here, there's a lot of signs of wear and age. And probably at some point they were just turned into rags. And of course, most men were buried in one of their nicer suits, jackets or coats.
Okay.
So there's probably a lot of them in the graveyards.
Okay. So, well, the frock coat is seen as the dressier of the jackets, and the sack coat's a little less formal. How does the duster fit into this conversation?
The duster would fit in as far as a traveling coat. If you traveled by the cars or train, there's a lot of cinders and dust and dirt. If you were traveling by horseback or wagon, of course, you're on dusty, dirty roads. There's no paved roads with concrete. They might have been macadamized or hard surface, but given the fact that not only were wagons on there, there was animals going to and from market and horses, there's a lot of dust and dirt and manure dust and stuff like that. So you wanted to protect your clothes.
Now, would this be worn over the sack coat or in place of?
It could be either.
Okay.
You could wear it in place of, but if you're traveling, it might be easier to, and you didn't get too warm, you could wear your sack coat and then this over, or even a frock coat.
Okay, and you mentioned there's another piece in your collection which you can show an image of that might be used for getting to work. Will you talk about that a little bit?
Oh yes, we do have a smock or overshirt. And my version is a smock without a collar, but overshirts too were worn. A second shirt that was lighter could be worn over your work shirt.
Okay,
and for example, if you were the blacksmith coming to work, you might work in your shirt sleeves, but you might have worn an overshirt to get to the blacksmith shop from your house.
Okay, great. And I see there's a handkerchief here.
Well, we all need to wipe our brow. And also you could use the handkerchief around your collar to keep the sweat off your shirt and just keep you a little drier.
Well, we're almost to the top of the man. Let's talk briefly. We don't have examples here, but let's talk briefly about how headgear figures into the summer.
Well, I've seen many examples, and I know I've seen them reproduced as well, as straw hats. And either they were naturally colored straw, or in the Navy, they had tarred and painted in black. So straw hats were quite fashionable and could be worn for many occasions, probably not formal occasions. Sometimes just a mechanic's cap or a small cap would have been worn.
Okay.
Men were still wearing, or continued to wear, hats all the time.
Okay.
So basically, though, if you were outside working out around your farm or something like that, and the hat would fall off or whatever, maybe you were in the shade, you could, of course, take it off and set it on the stump while you were working. But then when your neighbor came by or your wife came out, you'd put your hat back on.
And the straw hat, of course, the full brim around it, to provide a little bit of shade.
And the straw hats could take the form of top hats or broad-brimmed farmer's hats that we see pictures of.
Okay, great. Well, Bill, we've got other things to talk about in the future, but thank you very much for coming.
Pleasure.
It's exciting
to finally
get you here with us in the Digest.
Well, I'm glad to be able to share part of my collection, and hopefully it'll stir people that might have other items like this also to let us know that there exist, so that we can see them.
Absolutely. Well, thank you also for spending your time with Civil War Digital Digest, whether it's collecting originals, collecting photos, or actually reproducing and wearing some of these for living history. We hope this is giving you some other ideas how to find a connection to Civil War and the history that we all share as Americans.